Hello everyone and welcome to an online course on object-oriented programming using C++. So, object or programming languages allow programmers to develop softwares. So, there are three major families of programming languages. First is machine learning, which includes 0 and 1 programming. Second is assembly language. It is based on the mnemonics, add, sub, move. And the third is high level language, which is based on English words, which are logically connected. So the way you speak, the language will understand what you want to say, right? So these high level languages are classified into two types. One is procedure languages and other is object-oriented programming languages. So early high-level languages like C, COBOL, Fortran, or HTML are basically procedure languages. So what this object-oriented programming does? So it is based on the modeling data. It is an approach to develop software programming, that is C++, .NET, Java, and it basically tries to simulate real-life things into your program. So, OOP was introduced to overcome flaws in the procedure-oriented approach to the program. So, let us understand what is this object-oriented programming languages. So, imagine a situation in a class where you have a blackboard, right? Then you have students sitting, then you have a teacher, and then desk and benches. And there may be a fan, ceiling fan, or wall fan over here, right? So first of all, understand what is a class. So class is a collection of similar type of entities, right, called as objects. So similar type of entities means all the students are one entity. Both these are the similar kind. Right, then you can also include the teacher in along with the students, and you can name the class as person. If you include only students, then you can name the class as students, right? So if you include the furniture items, so you can give the class name as furniture. Okay. So what are these objects now? So object is a basic runtime entities which may represent a person or thing. So this student one can be called as object one of class student. Right. Similarly, this is student 2 can be called as object of class student. Similarly, this furniture 1 or table chair 1 can be called as an object of class furniture, right? Similarly, this teacher can be called as an object of class employee or staff, right? So the two terms are clear, that is class and object. Now, third terminology is attribute or properties. Now, these attributes or properties are characteristics that describes the object. So, for example, the name, if you take example of class student, so the name of the student is one attribute or characteristics. Similarly, his roll number can be another characteristic. His height or weight or mobile number or gender can be one of the attributes, right, relating to the student class. Similarly, if you take example of this teacher, so again you will have name, mobile number, salary, etc. If you consider an example of the furniture class, then color, height, weight, can be example of that attribute of the class furniture, right? Now the fourth is methods and functions. Now methods and functions are used to get, process and display attributes of the object. Now you may have multiple functions or methods to get the information regarding the different types of objects, right? You can have the functions to process on the data, and finally after processing to display results, you can have display functions, right? So we have seen class, object, attributes or properties, and methods or functions, right? Let us understand more in detail, that is concept part, with the help of example. Let us understand, if you create a class called car, so there are, you can have multiple objects, that is you may have a Honda car, Maruti Suzuki car, Hyundai car, Renault car, Kia car or Mahindra, and this can go on. Okay. If the focus is on Maruti only, so you can create a class Maruti. So it may have multiple objects. It may have 800, Alto, Baleno, Swift and so on. If your focus is on only Alto car, so you have a class called Alto, and then various models of this car can be the objects of this class, that is LXI, VXI, VDI and so on. So depending on the focus and requirement of programming, you can create multiple classes and you can create multiple objects. Now relating to this LXI model, for example, so you may have different attributes like cubic capacity, right? Then seating capacity, then cost and engine number of cylinders or engine type, whether it is inline cylinders, V cylinders, right? So you can have multiple attributes relating to class Alto. So similarly, these same attributes will be common to this second object, VXI model, right? So this attributes basically describes the characteristics of the class car, that is Alto, right? So depending on the focus, you can create different types of classes and you can create different types of objects and you can associate it with different attributes. Okay. Now let us see the features of OOP. So first is emphasis is on the data rather than procedure, right? Then programs are divided into what are known as objects. So data structures are designed such that they characterize the object, and functions that operate on the data of an object are tied together in data structure. Data is hidden and cannot be accessed by external functions. Objects may communicate with each other through functions only, right? The function which we will create for getting information, processing information and displaying information, right? Then new data and functions can be easily added wherever necessary, and it follows bottom-up approach in program design. Now all these features will be covered in subsequent videos. Okay. Quickly revise the data types. So you have integer data type, which represents roll number, age or some counter. Then you have float, which represents the decimal values, such as marks, height, salary, etc. Then you have a character data type, that is represented by char, which will include name, address, enrollment number and so on. Again, quickly we will revise some important terminology used, that is variable declaration, stating the type of variable, that is int I, float b, char, name, etc. Variable definition, that is stating the value of variable, I equals to 10, B is equal to 20.5, name is Ashish, right? So variable declaration and definition, that is in one statement, that is int I equals to 10, float b equal to 20.5 and so on. Now we will see the basic structure of a C++ program. So, and remember, C++ is a case sensitive programming language. Everything inbuilt is in lowercase. So first of all, it starts with inclusion of the header files. In the previous lectures we have seen, we have included iostream.h, we have included conav.h. So it starts with your header files, right? Then it starts with class. So you have, suppose, second year class second. So class, this is the class name, and this is the keyword called as class. Okay, so this is the class declaration and definition. In the similar way, you create an integer variable int I, right? So this is a class declaration and definition. So what you are doing in this, you are giving the class name and you are writing the body of the class. So the curly bracket, that means the class starts over here. Then you have two sections in the class. One section is called a private section. Other section is called as a public section. Okay, we will see what is private section and what is public section. Okay, then the class ends over here, followed by a semicolon. Remember, the semicolon is very, very important. Okay, and then here only you can write multiple classes, one after the other. Then after all the classes have been written, then you have to give void main, and then void main starts and void main ends. And there is no semicolon, right? So in case of class, you have to give semicolon. And since void main is a function, there is no need for the semicolon. Then, as I already told, that you can create multiple classes. So similar to that structure, you can have a third year class or fourth year class or first year class, right? Now, additionally, one thing we have given here, that is second S1. So S1 is the object of class second, right? You have a second year class, right? Just remember, imagine the picture. So this is, suppose, for example, second year class, and you are creating one of the objects, that is S1, right? It is very similar to integer I. Right, I belongs to data type int, right? Similarly, this second class is user defined data type. User defined data type, right? In the similar way, you can create S1 object of data type second class. Right. Similarly, you can create object S2 of third class. It is class third, right? Now coming back to the public and private data or variables. So since we have seen the features of hook, that it protects your data, right? So the data which is to be protected, or which you do not want to be accessed from outside the class, these variables are to be declared in the private section of the class, right? So the variables such as password or salary or maybe the account number or PAN number or Aadhaar number or your fingerprint data can be put in the private section. Okay, so depending on the requirement of the program, you can put or you can classify the variables in either private or public. And in public section, you can have maybe account number you can give in public or private depending on the need, right? So variable declared as a private can be indirectly accessed from public section of the class, right? Private variables cannot be accessed from the main function. So why we are naming it as private? Because this, the scope of the variables or accessibility of the variables declared inside the private is only limited within the class, right? You cannot access this from outside the class, that is our main function or some other functions. That's why these are called as private variables or private functions. You can declare and define variables as well as functions in private section or public section. Okay. Now the variables declared inside the private section can be accessed from public section, right? You can have full access because the public section is inside the class only. So you have to remember one thing, that the scope of the variables and functions declared in the private section can only be accessed within the class only and cannot be accessed from main function or other functions. Now, public section of the class. So variables declared under this section can be accessed from anywhere in the program. And that's why it is called as public. It is open to all. Okay. So let us understand how to display data in a basic C++ program. So I have created a class student. So here class will start, that is the definition of the class will start. Now by default it is private, so you need not to write this private keyword over here, right? If not written, it is assumed by default as private, right? But just for demonstration, I am writing here private. Then after writing private keyword, you have to give colon. Then I am declaring age as a private variable just for example. And second followed by public section, in which I have only given a function called showData. So inside showData, I am displaying I am showData function declared and defined in the public section. Then just to give the value of age and roll number like this. And then inside void main, I am creating one object of student class, that is S. That the syntax is class name, object name, and then a semicolon. Right? So if you want to understand this diagrammatically, so this is the class student you have created, and inside this you have created one object which is called as S, right? And the attributes related to the students is age, right? So these are the attributes which relates to the student. So even if you create hundreds of objects, this age attribute will be assigned to all these objects, okay, automatically. So whatever you declared inside the class, it will get attached to all the objects created. Okay. Now how to get data and display in a basic C++ program? Again the same example. Now I have created two variables inside private section, that is integer age and height. Then inside public, I have created two functions, one to get data, that is cout enter age and height of the student, then cin age and height, then void show data age and height. So I have created two functions inside the public section, right? So this getData function will access the age and height which are declared in the private section. Now in void main, I have created two objects, that is S1, S2, right? It is demonstrated here. Now whenever you do S1.getData, so Suppose this is the S1 object and this is the S2 object. S1 dot get data. So it will get age and height for this student 1, that is this object S1. Okay. Whenever you will do S2 dot get data, then it will get the data for this object, that is S2. Okay. Now, by mistake, if you do not get this and directly write s2.showData, then it will not display anything, right? Because S1, you have taken data in S1 object, right? And you are trying to access S2 object. You have not get any data inside the S2 object. If you want to see this diagrammatically, then you have S1 object. Whenever you do S1 dot get data, this dot represents the access. You can access the object, content of the object using dot operator. Okay. So whenever you do S1 dot get data, that means you are calling the function get data for S1 object. Okay. So suppose if you enter as age as let us say 20 and height as let us say 170 or 180. So whatever data you entered using this statement s1.getData, that will get accumulated in S1 object. But your S2 created S2 object is still empty. Right? To fill the values in S2 objects, you have to call s2.getData function. Okay, but by mistake you have written here s2.showData. So there is no values in s2 data, s2 object, right? So that's why it will show you nothing. So for that you have to write s1.showData, right? So this is the basic program, which is just to get data and display data. Again, it is written with description, class student, private variables age and year only accessed within the class and not from the main. Then in public, get data function declaration and definition. It can be accessed anywhere from the program. Similarly, show data function to display the values of age and year. This is void main, clear screen function, student s, user defined data type, object s is created of class student, s.getData, direct access to getData function, s.showData, direct access to showData function. Since both these functions are declared in the public section, you can access it directly using the dot operator. And finally, the getCH. Program will terminate until user presses any key, right? Now, in this program, one change is there, that is, we have declared and defined the getData function inside private section. Right here, private keyword is not written. So I have already told you that there is no need to write the private. It is by default private. Okay. So these are the private variables and private function, that is void get data. Right. And inside public section, you have only written show data function. Now, if you want to access the get data function, now you know that this getData function cannot be accessed from the main function because it is declared as private. But you cannot access directly, but you can access indirectly. So how to access it indirectly? That is, you will call this function inside the showData function. Now you have declared showData function in the public section of the class, right? So for calling getData function, you need to write only getData and then two parentheses followed by a semicolon. So this is the syntax for calling a function, right? So this is indirect access of private variables through public section, right? And then student s. Now if you write s.getData, this will not be called because you have declared getData function in the private section. So this will, the program will not allow you to do this. So you need to only access showData function, that is the direct access of showData function, and thereby indirectly accessing getData through showData, right? So in this way you can access it indirectly. Again, it is dependent on you how you write the program. It is not mandatory that you need to write getData function inside the showData function. This is just a way. Now you can define the functions inside the class and outside the class. So there are two ways of defining the function, that is inside the class and outside the class. So first way is inside the class, which we have already seen, and other ways outside the class, right? So for declaring the body of function outside the class, you need to use the scope resolution operator, right? So class student, then private, integer, age, height. In public, you have simply declared the function just to tell the compiler that you have two functions. One is getData and other is showData, right? Now you use this whenever your program is very complex and very large number of statements are there. So in that case, you can use this method, that is, you simply write declared number of functions over here, and then you define the body of the function outside the class. Okay. So how to do this? So for that, void. Now you have to specify the class name over here. That is, this getData function belongs to which class? So this tells compiler that this getData function belongs to class student. Okay. And the similar way, you can write the body over here. Again, it is up to you. You can write or you can define the body of functions inside the class as well as or outside the class. The choice is yours. Okay. So similarly, void student, scope resolution operator, and showData. This scope resolution operator is nothing but two colons. Okay. Then you have void main, student s1, s1.getData, and s1.showData. Remaining things are as it is. So classifying data as public or private and assigning values. So now we have a class employee, right? Then inside private, we have a variable salary as float. Then in public section, you have account number. Then you have a show data variable in function, right? Now in void main, you have created one object of employee class, that is even. Now you can assign the values directly here. That is even.accountNumber is equals to something like this. Now this will work because account underscore number is a public. You can assign the values here as well. Okay. But if you try to assign even.salary is equal to 59,000, this will not work because the salary variable is the private variable. You cannot assign values here. Okay. As I've already told that the scope of the variable or accessibility of the variable salary will be only within the class and not outside the class, okay, because it is private. So for that, this will not work. And then even showData will work because it is a public function. Okay. Now entering data from main function and passing it to a class. You can also do this. That is, I have created a class employee. inside private aggregate salary, then integer account number, then void get data. Now inside this I need two values, that is float salary and integer account number. Okay, so I have created two variables, sal in float and account number as int. Okay, now let us understand the running of the program. That is, it will run from void main, employee even. So even object will be created of employee class. Now you have to match the prototype of the function, that is the format of the function. So even dot get data, you need two values over here, that is one is salary value and other is account number value. So first value I am passing directly as 55,000 and second as account number. Okay, so this 55,000 will go into the salary and this account number will go into variable as account number. Now this sal will be assigned to salary and account number, AC number, will be assigned to account number. So this is also the one of the ways to give or provide the values to variable. You can use any way of assigning the values. Okay, this is just for demonstration. In the previous lectures we have already covered what is the meaning of return type void. So in case of a C++ program, object oriented program, let us understand this once again, that you have created a class second, you have created two variables inside private section, that is character private password and float salary. In public you have created account number, get data and show data. In main function you have created one object, that is s, and you are doing s.getData. Right, now since this getData function is sending no value back to main function, that's why it is void over here. Void means nothing. Okay, then let us change from void to int. Okay, now int. So if this is sending integer type data back to main function, then you will write here int, right? We have already seen this in previous lecture, so I will not give much time here. Similar to the float. So let us quickly understand the program to find out largest number of two user entered numbers. Okay, we have already done this program in normal C structure, but let us do this program using classes and objects. So for that I have created a class number, then I have created two variables, that is num1, num2. In public I have written functions to get data, process data. So inside get data I have written cout, enter two numbers, and cin, num1, num2. Okay. Now second function I have created, void find largest. Using conditional statements, if num1 is less than num2, cout largest number is num2, else cout largest number is n1. Okay, two functions I have created, one is get data, other is finding largest number. Okay, and then void main. First of all, clear screen, then one object is created of number class, then this is the object. Suppose this is a number class, then this is the object inside the number class, right? And you provide suppose n equals to 10. Okay, so not n equals to 10, this n is this, right? N is the object name, so n is this. N dot get data, so you need to enter num1. Suppose num1 equals to 10 and num2 is equals to 20, right? Then inside the n object, you will have num1 equal to 10, num2 equal to 20. Then n dot find largest. So it will check whether the num1 is less than num2. depending on the condition, it will print the number and then finally get CH, right? So this was the basics of object-oriented programming along with some programs. I request you to go through all the programs very slowly, understand the meaning of each and every line, okay? And if you still face any difficulty, you can comment below. Okay, so thank you for watching. Have a nice day.